Good morning, one and all. I am Prafullata Auradkar. I am a faculty of IIT department in KJ Somaiya College in Vidya Vihar. And actually, we are having an engineering branch in two campuses, in one in San branch and one in Vidya Vihar. And I would be representing Vidya Vihar branch. And in that one, altogether, we are having 5 branches of engineering offered, and altogether, it is having 120 intake per branch. So we would be having 10 classes for the first years, wherein we would be teaching computer programming 1. And with that one, like for computer programming subjects, it is taken care by computer and IT branch faculty. And for that one, we'll be having 2 coordinators allotted, one from computer department, one from IT department. And altogether, 10 faculty are teaching for the subject. 2 coordinators to coordinate the syllabus and to keep the synchronization. And for the evaluation, I would be coming on later, like how we are going to do. And with that background, I would like to have a look at the syllabus part first. And as we are affiliated to the Mumbai University, Mumbai University has revised the syllabus for computer programming since 3 years back. And the syllabus right now, what we have to follow are for CP1, first semester it is including C, C++ and the concepts of object-oriented programming. And for CP2, in the second semester, they are going to learn the Java as a programming language. And with the university thing, as we can see on the screen, we are taking 3 hours per week theory lectures and 2 hours per week for practicals. And there is no practical exam to be conducted for the subject. And for the theory evaluation, we are having total 125 marks allotted for that one. Out of that, 100 marks, the theory paper will be there at the end of the semester. And then 25 marks are the internal evaluations done, that is by the teaching faculty. And that are the term work marks. And for all that evaluation, we are having guidelines given by the university. And this is the syllabus pattern given. We are having structured programming using C++. So as a language, C++ is introduced. And then we are having prescribed hours for each of the topics given. And in that one, for the data input and output, that is the second chapter, as you can see, we are having printf and scanf statements as well. That means, and in the along with that, in the first chapter, it is mentioned that C++ has a superset of C. That means we should have a brief, we should give a brief idea to the students about C as a language. And for printf and scanf, we should be showing them the syntax of C and then proceed for the C++ as a language. And at the end of the chapter, at the end of the syllabus, we are having introduction to object-oriented programming in C++, where we are going to introduce about classes and objects. And then after that, that was about the total syllabus. And according to the prescription, it comes out to 38 lectures. And we, usually we follow 10 to 12 weeks maximum in a semester. So it comes out to 36 regular lectures. And on top of that, we should be struggling to take the extra lectures to cover the syllabus, which is a very difficult thing for us. And for the term work marks, as was asked earlier, they have to maintain a journal for the semester, and that journal, again, it is prescribed in the syllabus. They have to attach 25 programs. Whatever number of programs they are executing, that is different. But 25 should be there in their journal or their practical record. And for that 25, again, it is given like 5 programs on the fundamentals, 10 programs on the control structures like functions, arrays, data structures, all that part, and again 10 programs on the object oriented part. So like that, we have to design the total list of experiments, and then we are having the term work distribution for the marks. So as 25 marks are to be allotted by the teaching faculty, for that 25, again it will be like 5 marks for the total attendance including theory and practical, and 10 marks for the journal or the practical performance, and 10 marks for the test. And in our college, we are following, there will be 2 tests taken. One will be the midterm test and the other one will be the end term test. And these tests are to be of 50 marks each, and then total 100 marks will be reduced down to 10, and that marks are allotted for the student. and then there are recommended books given for the subject. So that was about the syllabus part. And for the evaluation pattern, it will be 100 marks paper. Out of that, 40 is the passing marks for the student. And then the question paper will be set in the university. And then the evaluations are also done in the university as a CAP analysis. So faculties are deputed from the college to the university wherein the corrections are done. And then again, results will be declared by the university. And coming down to the question paper pattern, again there is a standard pattern maintained where it is having total 7 questions given in the paper. Out of that, first question will be the compulsory question, and the pattern follows like each full question carries 20 marks. It can be a bigger question like one full program of some object oriented concept which carries total 20 marks, or it can be divided into 10 plus 10 or it can be 8 plus 12 like that. And then till now, like it's not given anywhere, written anywhere, that what will be the percentage of theory questions and the programming questions, but it is observed that it usually comes out to 50-50 or like 40-60, 60-40 like that. And where the students feel the difficulty is to write the programs. And this was about the term work mark earlier I have explained. And I am having a few question papers with me, the sample papers. These are the university question papers. The first question was the compulsory question, and then the rest 6 questions are there. Out of them, any 4 they have to attempt, 4 full questions. There are totally 3 papers, and questions like what would be the output of the following programs are also asked in the paper. So like we cannot skip even the smallest part of the syllabus given, like here as we see in the example, they are having that increment decrement operator and what will be the output of the program. And even like that, even for the logical operators like left shift or right shift, so they should be knowing the binary representation to calculate the shifting as well. So there they find it, we as a faculty find it difficult to cover that much detail for all the topics. And for the practical aspect, it was given, the rough guideline from the university was given like 5 programs on control structures, 10 programs on object oriented concept like that. And we have designed an elaborate list of experiments for the students, and in that one we are maintaining a list of practice programs, list of final programs. So students have to attach the final programs in their journal, and the practice programs are for their practice. So they would be practicing in their lab notebooks which they are maintaining. So that will be a writing practice as well as for the implementation part. And here as I am having only the first 10 experiments out of those 25. Final plus some practice programs, and then we have to give the next 15 programs, and these details are loaded onto the intranet where the students have access to them. And then for the next list, actually right now I am not having that, I would be mailing them to the coordinators.
If you see the syllabus, very nicely the syllabus states that C++ is a superset of C, and then you have, if you look at your input output, C in and C out are mentioned like also ran somewhere in that list, but you always scanf, printf, get car, everything. Is it not tantamount almost to say that for a major part of the course, people be writing C programs and compiling them using C++?
No, sir. They are writing C++ programs and they are running it in.
What is C++ in most of the earlier part?
Yeah, you can say that. Only C in, C out would be
so
there.
So here is a simple test. Whatever programs they submit, compile them using GCC, not C++, and see how many errors you get. My guess is you will not get a single error, unless you are using C in and C out. That those will be the only 2 things. That is natural, and there is nothing wrong with that. And that is why now in retrospect, we also have exactly a similar situation, by the way. We do not say C++, we say programming principles using C, C++ or Java, but that is left to the instructor. And that first course, the syllabus is not decided by the CS department, it is decided by other engineering departments, because their students are being trained in the first course more than the CS students. So what they say is, CS students, you want to do something else, you teach them separately, but common course must have this. Now the way we have evolved our course looks very similar to this. But if you see majority of the places, there is a separate course in fundamental C programming and there is a separate course in C++.
So with the earlier syllabus it was like that. For CP1, for the first sem they were having Unix with C programming.
Right.
And for second sem it was C++ with object oriented concepts.
Right.
And with the revision we are having this.
Unix, so they have pushed it down. Yeah. Don't the teachers find it slightly difficult?
It's very difficult, sir. Like to explain the basic things like printf, scanf are the function calls and cin, cout are the objects. Like since the beginning the problem is there. And students feel that cin, cout are the substitute for printf and scanf.
That's
which
right.
is not there.
That's right. In fact, I have permitted them to believe so. There's no harm.
It goes on, sir, whatever we struggle for.
Okay, okay. I think the issue is to when you try to emphasize that object-oriented concepts are something special and different than procedural concepts. So there cannot be any object-oriented programming language which does not encompass basic procedures. The basic procedures have to be there. So when you talk about control structures, if then else, for, while, there is nothing object about it. No, that is required anywhere and that is very fundamental logic. So I believe that is stressed everywhere, whether it is Bombay University or any place. But array as a data structure of variables is distinctly different from, object classes. You take struct, for example. Now, struct and class are two slightly different paradigms. Mm. But you can do the same thing using both. Don't students get confused when you do that?
Yes, sir, surely.
I would think that even teachers would get confused. Anyway, that is life, I guess.
So I wanted to use this platform to have one more clarification for my side.
Huh.
Like one of our senior faculty members is he is insisting to do one experimentation. Like with the syllabus, we were having difficulty. Like first thing, we have to make them, the student, understand what is procedure oriented, because we start with what is machine language, what is assembly language. Like first few lectures are with that only, and then we move forward for the different languages, and then we are hardly able to touch the object oriented concepts at the end of the semester. So like what he is insisting is we can start our all first with the object oriented programming itself, then we will move top down.
Yeah,
because as you said, like all control structures and all these things we will be using there also.
Yes.
So like since beginning we will make a habit of writing classes and objects.
Well, yes and no. I mean it all depends upon what you want to connect. As long as the student can solve problems using some programming. In my yesterday's lecture, I taught them awk in 5 minutes and told them how a tough lab assignment for which they are going to struggle for about 2 hours can be solved in a 10-line program. Now, having taught awk, I will ask questions in the NSEM on awk. Now, that is not permitted in Bombay University. There is a prof in Thrissur or Calicut who gave a talk here on teaching programming. He has joined IIT Gandhinagar now. So, he teaches computer programming using HTML and web. And he says the most decent computer programming program development environment is the web. Why do you require compilers and this and that? You can actually, if you take JavaScript for example, just JavaScript, you can convey all the control structures, all the notion of parameters, references, everything. And as a added attraction, you tell them to solve practical problems. Train reservation, design a screen, collect the thing. You can even lead to databases at the back end. So these are different, I don't think, as I said at the beginning, there's no unique answer to that. The problem with most teachers is that when you say this is the way you have to teach because this is the way I will examine, then teachers lose their liberty to do the experimentation.
Here mostly the students ask us on arrays, what are the major programs asked till now and what are the solutions
for
that?
No, but I will also point out one more thing. You see, this present company is a very special company. You all come from good institutions, you all have experience in teaching. The 1,000 teachers that we are talking about, I am not even sure that all of them would be competent programmers. There would be situations where 90% of the students within first 3 months you'll become better programmers than teachers. And ultimately we are targeting all our efforts in giving something to the students. That's the reason why I insist that teachers doing any training program must write programs as they would expect students to write. There's no shortcut to that. So that is one part of the part and parcel of the training. You know, why 15 days program, why 2 weeks full-time program? It's because teachers have to do the labs exactly like the others do. And this is the last question I wanted to ask you. 25 programs are to be submitted by students. Now, even if you have 10 teachers, okay, one teacher responsible for what? 60 students. 60 into 25.
Sir,
I will bet that no teacher will be able to physically read all 25 programs submitted by a student.
Sir, 10 teachers for theory lectures. One teacher would be conducting the theory lecture for one class or one division.
No, then who checks the lab?
And for practicals for 3 batches are there for 60 students, 20, 20, 1 batch is done.
Okay.
And batches are allotted for separate teachers.
Okay, so 25 students.
20 students
20
per
students
teacher.
Into 25 programs, 50 programs, and I am the teacher. Okay, I still give the same bet. I am willing to lose a whiskey bottle if you guarantee that all teachers for all labs read 25 into 2, that is 20, that is 500 programs physically. I would think it is impossible. I don't know what is, you would know, right?
So actually how we do is like per session we allot some 2 to 3 programs they have to perform, and like in a batch whatever difficulties they are having they will put forward, like some errors are coming, some logical problems, something of that sort.
Correct.
And so we will help them out to solve that.
So
and that the next session when they are coming, the next lab, they have to bring us the fair copy.
Correct.
So that will be
but the final journal that they will submit, they will still be at liberty to replace an older program with a new one.
That will be
now here is a question. How can you ever imagine catching copying in the final submission? It is impossible. We ask students to just tar their files and submit that tar as a submission. So we have a common submission pool. So the date, timestamp, and the student's login is automatically logged in there. And then we do something else. We are just trying this for the first time because we have had instances where people submitted an assignment which was done by some other student 2 days ahead by grabbing that. So we are putting in a piece of software to find out similarities between programs. So about, let's say about 6 assignments they have submitted and 800 students, so about 4,800 programs, and they could have multiple documents there. Over the next few days as we speak, they will all be analyzed to find out similarity. So such software, I think there is some open source software, we are augmenting it, but we should include that as part of the distribution, so teachers can have this one. You see, I will tell you the reason for this. Ordinarily, if we are not strict about it, then more and more students will be inclined to copy programs. But we can't be strict about it because it is physically impossible to cross-check this. Now, this is a chicken and egg story. Unless we break this knot somewhere, we'll not be able to encourage students to do their own work. Like I was speaking, first time when I heard this, I was so shocked that MCA and B final year projects in some places in Tamil Nadu, they were available for sale, it seems. Then as I was traveling to Anna University, that fellow showed me a big this thing. It said assistance to engineering students. And that is a nice name to say that you pay me so much money, your project will be done. And when I expressed my shock, Krishnan said there's hardly anything that we can do about it, except for while evaluating the student. If we find out the student has not done much, then he can fail or get less marks. But they get away without doing such work. When I was expressing this shock in a meeting in Delhi, the Vice Chancellor of IGNOU tells me, he says, the Vice Chancellor of Uttar Pradesh Technical University told me the Uttar Pradesh is very common. And the IGNOU Vice Chancellor told me that Delhi has a refined version. So if you just want a project report, it costs 3,000 rupees. But if you want 8-hour coaching on defending that project report, additional 2,000 rupees. Now this is ridiculous. I mean, now, why this is happening is that we have no mechanism of cross-checking. So, what mechanism do you use? I mean, this is outside the syllabus and technical teaching, but this is an important part of educational process.
Because typically project submission, if you think, just if it is allowed to do at the end only, then this is very difficult to cross-check. So whatever regular submissions are possible, like fortnightly, whatever developments have been, that should be reported. A journal kind of file kind of thing can be maintained at the teacher, where he will submit those pages or whatever has been done and be recorded periodically. Only then we can say that they have done themselves.
So in fact, then one suggestion would be, we'll just find out, because two things I found are missing. Revision control system, either CVS or RCS. I don't know how many of you use similar systems, because in turbo environment, if your group projects, for example, now there are three or four people who are developing the same functions or programs. Now I put in a version, you put in a version, there could be huge confusion. So like any project development, even if I'm doing it alone, I should have a control system for that. And these things exist in Unix environment. I do not know the corresponding thing. There must be similar systems also in the Microsoft environment. But it appears to me, because none of you spoke about it, I don't think your students or labs use that environment right now. No, nobody uses them. And one of the reasons is, because I did not use it till now. Okay, I used it after I stopped teaching programming courses. Although Unix environment had the revision control system even in the early days. Okay. But subsequently, all teachers have been using it. And I found out why. I had never used it myself. Whereas all the other younger teachers had used it. Now, I will be using it. Now, if we take 1,000 teachers, the likelihood of these teachers themselves having ever used RCS are very remote. In fact, many of you might not have used revision control system. So I will spend about 10, 15 minutes tomorrow sometime to describe the RCS, and I'm making RCS part of our distribution, so that that will be done. A few advantages of RCS is that in final submission, even though we track it electronically by asking them to put a tar file, the final tar file only comes to us. But if I have RCS, I have RCS log. I can know exactly what day, how many lines were written, I can extract deltas, and I can see which day what program portion was there. Progressive development. Now, suddenly in that progressive development, a major program appears as a new one. Obviously, it's a copy. Anyway,
so yeah, please. I would like to add, regarding that project evolution, what we do at our place, we have got a project card given to every student. So every week, what the student does, he has been allotted a guide. So every weekend, he has to check with the guide. He will show his progress. And on the progress card, that is project card, he will write what he did in that particular week. And the guide will put a signature. So that way we go on progressively evaluating the projects. It is not like at the end of the same, they just come up with the project. But every week they have to go to the guide and show the project development, and the guide will see it and put his remarks over there. And after that, like after every 1 month, we'll have a project evaluation team. The team goes there and they will evaluate the project, irrespective of the guide. Sometimes it may be possible that the guide will have soft corner for his student. So we just form the teams and they evaluate them. For the main project.
So I would like to get your expert opinion about the project evaluation part of external projects, which the students do outside. For example, MCA projects are external, right? So we do find this problem not very often. If he or she is an average student, they can get a very good project, excellent project from some outside agencies like this, and they can train them. And even though we have internal periodical evaluations, they go to the guide and explain everything. All this evaluation is happening, but still we find it very difficult to get to know that whether it is really done by the student or something like that. So what could be the a better mechanism to find? We do feel that it is not done by him, but there is no proof, because he's presenting in an extremely well manner. He has learned everything.
Yes.
He's thorough with the technology, language, everything is fine, but we understand that it's not done by the student. It rarely happens. So is there any mechanism to
As a matter of fact, the worst case is when our own students, let's say two people have gone out, one fellow has actually slogged very hard, done something, and has submitted that, worked for full 6 months. The other fellow is a street smart person who went to that Chennai shop or Delhi shop, got the project, paid 2,000 rupees, got trained. He is more articulate than the other person.
Yes.
And he comes back and scores many more marks than the other fellow. this is non-solvable as long as the project is done outside. In IIT Bombay, we do projects. If companies want projects to be done, they sponsor it. But there is a guide for the project in IIT Bombay. Who is responsible for certifying something, something, whatever, whatever. So there is no solution, there is no clean solution to this. Either the level of ethics among students is so high that they will not indulge in it. That is impractical. Even though the students are not bad people per se, but they will be tempted. You know, there are 100 marks there, I don't have time, I want to do something else.
Yeah, yeah, they'll
and
be busy
my father has 5,000 rupees, so what's your problem? Okay. Now, this problem is not solvable. But if we have ever a complete set of programs ever submitted by anybody in any university, and if we can subject that to such tests, of similarity tests, then we can find that out. I mean, why? Papers are found out like that. Technical papers. Plagiarism is being caught like that. We get routinely letters from IEEE and others saying, Professor Sridhar Iyer, this paper has been verbatim quoted for three paragraphs by a paper submitted by somebody wherever, let's say Jharsuguda. Now what action can we take? So if grown-ups can be tempted to do this, why do we blame the students? I mean, this is not good, but this is what will happen. You can only subject them. So see, problem is that even in those few cases where you are able to establish that the student has not done it, you only wrap the student on the knuckle and leave him. You don't fail him. You don't throw him out of the institution. There is no exemplary punishment that is ever given. If what is exemplary punishment is sets example. So we also become lax. And frankly, I don't know how this problem is solved. But I am definitely aware and I am concerned about it. So that is what I was saying. Smaller, our coming back to our issue, whenever we have this notion of 25 program submission, etc., etc., this notion, I think, is not correct. Weekly submission, as most of you said, and you also mentioned that you will ask them to submit
and
that.
And that grades we are maintaining in the teacher's record.
Okay, okay.
So that is done. But what? Like at the end of the semester, all the sheets are there or not, to check that one, it is difficult.
No. So instead, why not we all decide? We are talking of programming. Why can't people submit their programs and documentation electronically only? Why do they have to submit papers with signature? Because if you can do a DVD backup routinely, okay, let's say 5 or 10 submissions, 10 DVDs for all the entire class, I think you have solid records as far as the legality is concerned. And the students cannot fake things later on. So this is just one suggestion for the programming course. And maybe if we initiate this, the teachers who attend our training program could start using it for other subjects that they teach as well. One solution for your thing is, generally the students who do their projects externally will come back only on the last day to submit the project. No, not periodic. The following you should insist on. Every week, whatever code he has written, it must be mailed to you. It doesn't matter. You don't have to test. He can email. He should email the code, this file, with date. Now those files will be with you. That will force the student either to purchase it well in advance, but then he cannot submit it, all of it, on the first week. So he'll have to study it and show, okay, today I have written this, then tomorrow I have written this. Believe me, if he does that, he has understood programming. So at least partial purpose is solved. But this submission, a weekly submission kind of thing, if you make it mandatory, that doesn't matter. In 1 week, if you have not written any code, you say no code written. But if he says for 5 weeks no code written and 6th week suddenly a code appears, then you know that there is some problem. So these kind of simple tricks you can play with it. But I have no other advice to give.
Okay, thank you very much.